in the same what we have discussed. Okay, whatever the modalities comes, whatever the advancement comes, always my user expects a little extra mile from my side, from the manufacturers, right? Let's say earlier there was CT scan machine with 8 slices. 8 slice CT scan machine was there first. Okay, then later 16. Okay, then 32, then 64. Okay, now 200, 400 slices. Machines are there in the market. Okay, so the more we are advancing, the more my customer is demanding. The more advancement I am making, the more my customer is becoming demanding. Okay, earlier the CBCT is coming up with a single FOB, 8.5 into 8.5 or 6.5 into 6.5. Okay, then what happened, you know? One codec came with the FOB of 11.5 mm into 11.5. My customer has started demanding 11.5 into 11.5, but my customer don't know that what is the purpose of having 11.5 into 11.5. My customer, my dentist, don't know why I want 11.5 into 11.5. Okay. Then another company came into the market, I will not take the name. They came with the idea of having multiple FOBs. Means my dentist can select the area of scan 6.5 into 6.5, 6.5 into 7.5 or 7.5 into 11.5. So you can select accordingly. Right. Now if you can select accordingly, now the machines which are coming with the fixed FOBs that are no use for you. Right. So this is how the advancement comes, and all the market challenges are associated with the goal which I have told you, that is every imaging system needs a differentiation power. Okay, that whatever you are scanning, you can differentiate between the tissues, you can differentiate between the densities, you can differentiate between the different parts. That's a need of every imaging system. And whatever we will going to study, talk about RVGs and RVGs, like your line pair per mm, your grayscale, your bit depth, your technology CMOS or CCD, these all, you know, discussions. These all discussions goes only on the basis of one thing, that is the goal which I have told you. Clear? Okay. So these are the challenges. And here with the dental x-rays or dental imaging, the major aspect is to understand the x-ray tube. Okay, in dental imaging, the major thing which you need to know is X-ray tube, because either it's CBCT, it's OPG, or your normal conventional IOPA, intraoral periapical views. Okay, all uses X-ray tube, all are based on X-ray, right? Either it's OPG, CBCT, or your sensors or your normal films, right? Now, how the X-rays works, how the X-ray is generated. Okay, actually this is a very raw diagram of X-ray tube. In X-ray tube we have one filament, okay, which is supplied with very high voltage in range of kVs, that is kilovolts, in range of kVs. And when the filament is supplied with the high energy, high electrical power, what happens? That filament get excites, and that excitation of filament causes one emission which is known as thermionic emission, It means that the emission of thermal, there is two words, thermionic emission. Okay, thermionic emission has two things in it, a thermal and electron. Okay, thermal and electron. Thermal is nothing but heat. Okay, so, and heat is none of my concern. My concern is what? My concern is electron. Okay, so the electron beam is release from here, and this filament side is basically known as cathode side. Cathode is nothing but your negative polarity, right? And electrons are also negatively polar. Electrons are having which charge? Negative charge. And negative charge will always attract towards positive. Okay, so we have an anode which represents the positive polarity. Okay, and we maintain a positive polarity on your anode. What happens? the electron which generated from the cathode side from the filament get attracts to the anode. Okay, on the anode there is a specific area. Let's say this is my anode. Okay, so I don't want that electron should strike on whole anode, right? There is a specific area on the anode which is known as focal spot or a target. Okay, just take a note of this word, focal spot or a target. That specific area on anode is known as focal spot, or sometimes it is known as target. A focal spot or target is an area where we want an electron beam which is generated from your filament is supposed to hit. It's supposed to hit on the that focal spot or target. Okay. Clear? Now, once they hit on the target or focal spot, okay, the electron which hits at the target or focal spot, because of this collision of electron on the your target or a focal spot, the X-ray is generated. Okay, X-ray can be of two types. X-ray can be of two types. One is your characteristics X-ray. Okay. And another, you can call it as secondary X-ray or Gramsci-Long X-ray. Okay, characteristics X-ray and another name is characteristics is known as primary X-rays. Okay, characteristics X-ray is a primary X-rays, and your secondary X-ray is your Gramsci-Long X-ray. Okay,
Grams.
B-R-A-M. Grams.
The first one spelling.
Characteristics.
Spelling.
C-H-A-R-A-C-T-E-R-T-I-C-S. Characteristics X-ray. Okay. Yeah. And second one is Gramsci-Long. Okay, just do remember this name. Gramsci-Long is the name of the scientist who discovered this pattern of X-ray generation. Okay. Who discovers the pattern of this X-ray generation. Right. Now the question is, we have a characteristics X-ray, more characteristics X-ray or more Gramsci-Long X-ray. Right, there are two types. So which one we are getting? We are getting more over Gramsci-Long X-rays. Okay, we are getting the Gramsci-Long X-rays more. Okay, now what's the difference between characteristics and Gramsci-Long? Okay, Gramsci-Long and characteristics, to understand this Gramsci-Long and characteristics, just pay attention. See, every atom has a structure like this, right? And the shells are there, K, L, M, N, O, P. Okay, these are shells, right? K shell is this one. This one is your K, this one is your L, M, N, and as you go out, O, then P, then Q. Got this point? When the electron comes from the outside, from the filament, okay, when electrons come from the outside from the filament on the target, the atoms are present like this on the focal spot. Clear? Now there would be a electrons on this. Okay, on this there would be a electron. Okay, if there would be an electron, what will happen? This electron will hit this electron. What will happen because of the collision of these two electrons? What will happen? This electron and this electron, both will go out. Got it? Both will go out. Now what will happen? There is a vacancy created. There will be a vacancy. And that vacancy will be filled by whom? That vacancy will be filled by whom? With your nearby shell. Okay. An electron will come from here to here to replace this vacancy. This much is clear? Now, when I go from inner to outer, the energy level is
goes increasing. Okay, means the energy level of A is lesser as compared to the energy level of L, and L has a lesser as compared to the energy level of M. Means here we have a higher energy and here we required a lower energy. Right. Now when the electron will come from here to here, so let's say the here it requires E2 and here is energy 1. Right. So what, how much energy would be lost? How much energy would be released? You know, there would be extra energy. There would be extra energy. So the delta E can be calculated by E2 minus E1. The energy required, okay, minus energy present. But if the difference between the energy will be your X-ray which is released. The difference between the energies, the extra energy which is released is nothing but since your X-ray. Is your X-ray. Got this? Should I repeat it again? Should I repeat it? Okay. No issues. Just pay attention once again. I'll try to make it more simplified for you. Okay, see, on the target, just understand this fact very well. Okay, this is a generation method and I wanted everyone to understand because your AC and DC and generation concept will be clear from here on. Atoms are like this. Okay, now these are known as our shells. What are the shells are? K, L, M, N, O, P and Q. These are the shells.
The names.
Yes, these are the names.
We can place as A, B, C.
No. These are the fixed names. That's why the characteristics X-ray is sometimes known as K-shell energy also. Okay. Sometimes it is known as K-shell energy. How you have to name it? K, L, M, N, then one more circle. O, one more circle. P, one more circle. Q. One atom goes like this. Now, in each cell, there will be a specific electrons.
Numbers.
Okay. How these numbers are?
Yes, sir. Two.
Huh?
Two. First is two and eight.
The numbers are calculated in form of 2^n. 2^n. Okay. How n? 2^n. This k is assigned to number 1. L is 2. M is 3. N is 4. 5. 6 and 7. Right. Now, if I talk about K, so 2^n means 2^1. 2^1 means how much? 2. So, K will always have 2 electrons. Got it? Clear this much? Now, let's talk about L. 2^2.
4
electrons. So, L will always have 4. Right. Let's say for M, 2^3. How much?
8.
So M will always have 8. Right. Now, the energies, which is energy which is saved by each and every shell, is different. K will have the lowest energy. Whereas, as we move inner to outer, the energy level will increase. Okay, means the K will have a lesser energy as compared to L. L will have a lesser energy as compared to M. M will have a lesser energy as compared to N. N will have a lesser energy as compared to O. O will have a lesser energy as compared to P. And P will have a lesser energy as compared to Q. So the highest energy would be offered by your Q. And the lowest would be K. Means whenever any electron will come from any other shell to replace the K, okay, there would be an extra energy. There would be an extra energy, right? Let's say the electron here at L have 10 unit of energy with it, right? But the requirement on K is only 2. The requirement on K is only 2 unit of energy. Now what will happen? The amount of available energy is how much? 10 minus 2?
8.
Right? 8 unit is available. So where this 8 unit will go? This 8 unit will come out in form of X-rays. That 8 unit will come out in form of X-rays. X-ray is about, is an energy in motion, radiation, energy in motion. So difference between the energies of two electrons belongs to different shells. Okay, the difference comes into energy in form of energy, and that energy is nothing but your X-ray. And the difference, when the electron shift from here to here, the difference will be coming out in form of X-ray. This is your characteristics X-ray or a K-shell bind energy. Okay, got it? Characteristics is clear?
Yes.
This case is clear? Anybody is having any doubt, you can ask me.
Sir, I mean,
yeah, tell me.
No, sir, nothing doubt. How can we say that the electron beam targets only the K-shell?
Yes, it's a good question. How we can say this electron beams only target the K-shell? Okay, let me tell you. This will be defined by how much, at what kelp the electrons are being produced. At what kelp the electrons are being produced. Okay. And depending on the material, which is material of the focal spot or your target. It depends on two things. The kelp you have applied on the filament side and the material of your focal spot will ensure it will strike on K shell. Okay, if it strikes on K shell, the characteristics or the characteristics radiation will produce, right? But that is why it is not defined that all the energies will strike at K shell. That is why there is another generation that is known as Bramstrom X-rays, or you can say it's a secondary X-rays. Okay, because we are not sure. Right, the technology doesn't say, physics are not supporting this theory exactly. So that's why we have another generation method. Let's have a look to that another generation method is. This method is clear. Okay, K-shell energy is clear. Okay.
That means that K-shell electrons comes with high energy, then other cells electrons comes at low energy. So we classify that two as secondary.
No, K-shell electrons are having low energy, other shells are having high energy. The shifting from other shell to K-shell, okay, what will happen? K-shell requires a less energy and other cells requires a high energy. So means L-shell electrons will have a higher energy as compared to K-shell energy. Now when L-shell electron will shift to K-shell, okay, the energy difference between the requirement of K
is high.
Okay, the difference, that is delta E, and that would be released in form of your X-rays. Clear? Okay. The other thing is, again I will draw the same atom. Okay. The center here, what is this? This is basically a nucleus. That is your nucleus of your atom, that is center. And in nucleus basically we have neutrons and protons. Neutrons and protons, right? Now your electron is negative charge head. It will feel a force of attraction at center. When my electron will come, it will feel a force of attraction, right? So my electron is coming with very high speed, very high velocity from filament to the your atom or target. Now what will happen when electron is coming here during the approach to the center? Okay, what will happen? This electron will collide multiply. Once collision with this, one collide with this, once collide with this, and it will make a projectile in this way. Right. Let's say here it has energy of 20, right? First collision it becomes 16. Second collision it becomes 12. Third collision becomes 8 and final collision becomes 0. Getting this point? First collision will be the highest, and as soon as it will collide further, it will reduce. So the change 20 to 16, 16 to 12, 12 to 8, and 8 to 0. The difference, okay, let's say 20 to 16. The difference is 20 minus 16, 4. 16 to 12, 16 minus 12, 4. Then 12 to 8, difference is 4. So this difference of energy, loss of energy, will release